We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Jeff tucks spindles, then he installs brakes and doesn't wear safety glasses. Hey, you'll shoot your eye out, Ben.
Hurt, don't it?
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll-free.
Dude, where's Benny?
Who?
Tall guy, porn stash, works here.
That thing that goes on there. That guy, yeah. He said something about going outside. You know, cleaning a brake,
rotor?
It's something like that, man. I don't know, I just run the cameras.
Thank you.
When you get new brake rotors, they're gonna be covered with a rust inhibitor, and that's to protect the rotors from getting all rusty and nasty, but you really need to clean that off because it's like oil, and you really don't want oil on your rotors when you're trying to stop your car. Right tool for the job is brake parts cleaner. It dries clean, it doesn't leave any residue, and you don't want any residue in there that's gonna affect the performance of your brakes.
Dude, you really need to put on your safety glasses.
Nah, I don't need safety goggles for this, it's okay. Oh, God, that burns. Oh, jeez, where's the hose?
Hurts, don't it?
Oh, that burns. What level of hell is this? Where's the hose?
I'll go get the hose. All right, now what I've got here in front of us are a set of spindles. Now, one of the things I've noticed on the internet is that guys will go in and say, oh, just use a spindle out of a mid-60s Ford and you'll be okay. While that may be true, 1967 on up, and even that's not really true, it's not really true on an earlier Mustang. And what I'll tell you about that is this. You're gonna be screwing with the geometry of the front end of the steering on the car. These cars are horrible for bump steer as it is now. And you start going in and putting later model spindles on early cars, it can have a negative effect to bump steer on the vehicle. What I've got on the table in front of me are this. We've got the spindle that we got from Oswald's Classic Mustang, and we've got another spindle that we got from Bob that's out of a 1967 on up Mustang. Now, the spindle is marked C6OZ. Now, that tells us that this is, in fact, a Fairlane spindle, and they did use 66 Fairlane spindles on the 67 on up Mustangs. It's the same spindle for them, but the one behind it is an early spindle. This is the one out of a 65 Mustang. You'll notice immediately that there's a difference in relationship between the angle of the spindles on our ruler that we have down here on the table. We've pretty much centerlined these two so that they're on the same plane. And you'll notice that the spindle on my right is actually a little further over this way compared to the spindle on my left, which is in more. They're also a little bit different in height as well. Now, why Ford did that, I don't know. Maybe they were trying to pick up on the later cars with some of the things that we get with a negative camber wedge kit that we put on the 65. I'm not sure. But the big thing I wanted to show you is this. You'll notice with the silver ruler that there's a great deal of distance between the position here on the outer tie rod end on the newer spindle and the older spindle. The change of this arm and the position of this arm, which this spindle is actually deeper, and this one is shallower in your sitting inside the car. All these little things are gonna add up to make it bump steer possibly a little worse. Now, the Granada spindles that a lot of guys like to run on these cars with the disc brakes on them, it does induce more bump steer on an earlier car like a Falcon or a 65, 66 Mustang. And I'm talking about 64 and 65 Falcon. Bump steer issues can come through on that. Better to go in and do what we're doing with this brake kit, kind of like the one we're using from stainless steel brakes on our 65 Mustang and use an original spindle for now. Now, if you're going racing, you're gonna be changing up a lot of those things and it's not gonna make that big a deal. On a street car, my personal preference is to go in and actually use an early spindle if I can get my hands on them because quite frankly, that's the way Ford set it up. That's how the front end was done back in the day. And you want to kind of keep that going on the car if you at all possibly can. So, that's my 2 cents worth.
In front of me are some of the non-standard tools that you'll need in order to complete this job. So first thing is the brake parts cleaner. You definitely want to use brake parts cleaner because it doesn't leave any residue, but like we talked about throughout the video, be careful you don't get it on anything rubber and keep it off your paint job. Rubber mallet. Nothing really special here except you will need a rubber mallet potentially to get your drums off and also to get the wheel bearing cover on and seated correctly. You will need line tools for the brake lines. These are the right tool for the job for disconnecting and reconnecting your brake lines. For this job, we'll need the 5/8 and we'll need the 3/8. Now, if you get lucky and you don't have to replace your spindle, you won't actually need these tools, but in our case, we had to replace the spindle. The pitman arm tool is really handy for being able to remove the tie rod ends and the ball joints without damaging the seals. Now, if you have a real stubborn one, you may need to get a pickle fork kit, because that's also the right tool for the job for disassembling some of those suspension components. The wheel bearing packer is optional, but it does make repacking the wheel bearings a whole lot easier. According to the instructions, we may need to trim a little piece off of the rotor guards, and in order to clean that edge up once you make that cut, we have a reamer tool. This is one of my favorite tools. This is really great for pulling out the cotter pins. With the pointy end and the head of the cotter pin, you can fling it right across the shop. A pair of channel locks comes in handy for tightening up your wheel bearing nut. You don't necessarily need vice grips, but just a good pair of channel locks that you can grab onto that with. For initially seating the wheel bearings, you want to be able to get a little bit of torque on there. And we'll probably need a wire brush to clean some of the parts as we take them off and put things back together. We just like to detail it up a little bit as we go along. All right, now let's get to it.
All right, now what we've done here is this. We're going in and actually replacing a spindle. Now this is not typically part of a brake job, but around here, these kind of things seem to happen to us quite a bit. So what we did is this. Rather than taking apart the entire front suspension in order to replace the spindle, what we've done is we've created a stand for the upper control arm assembly to keep it up in the air. Now what you do is you'll take and jack up the suspension off the bottom plate here of the lower control arm and get the suspension to where it's actually sitting on the tires. And we did this. We took a piece of 1-inch box tube like this here, cut it to 6 inches in length, and we're putting it on around this piece here, and we're sitting it on the lower sill of the frame rail here. And that's basically, oddly enough, what Ford did with their stuff. Their setup was a little different, but it was an actual tool that you could have probably gotten from Snap-on back in the day that you're probably never going to be able to find. So the box tube will work just fine for what we're doing, especially if you're doing like we're doing and using a ball joint separator rather than a pickle fork, because you're not going to be putting a ton of horizontal stress on it by hammering on it. You're just going to actually be using force of the tool to separate the lower ball joint from the spindle and the upper spindle mount as well. So, I'm gonna get my safety glasses on and get busy. I know, sexy, right? All right, basically we're gonna use a 3/4-inch wrench to take this lower ball joint loose. And this tool is something you can get at a lot of the auto parts stores. KD also offers it. We recommend it for this kind of stuff because you don't wreck the boots if you're going to be reusing your control arms. And yes, it's always a little scary when that happens. All right, now we're going to go and do the top one. When you're putting these on, make sure that you're on the metal and you're not pinching the boot in between, because you can actually do that. Make sure you're sitting on the metal on the front and rear on this setup. All right, now our spindle's loose, we'll be able to go in and replace it.
Now that we have the rotor all cleaned up, we can go ahead and pack the inner wheel bearing, and I ain't taking any chances.
What are you doing?
I like to use a wheel bearing packer, but some of the older guys like to hand pack the wheel bearings.
All right, there's two ways you can do this. You can do this the way Vinny's doing it.
The right way.
It's not the right way, it's just a different way.
Okay.
Now, I have to admit that the tool is a lot easier to use and it gets
sometimes
a good, complete greasing of the bearing compared to doing it with a hand pack. Now, I also like to use Mobil 1 grease because Mobil 1 is a nice synthetic grease, good stuff, holds up really well, and we've used it on a lot of different projects. Really like this stuff.
All right, and make sure everything is really clean. You don't want any dirt, grit, or anything besides grease on your wheel bearing.
Now, if you're going to hand pack a wheel bearing, what you want to do is put the bearing grease in your hand and scoop around the race. Now, the reason I actually prefer the tool that Vinny is using is it's you get a lot more grease on the inside of the bearing set than you will with a hand pack. It's a lot harder to get the grease in here, and besides, you get grease all over your hand. You're going to keep wearing that all day long.
I ain't getting grease in my eye. How come you don't have your safety goggles on?
If I get grease in my eye, we got a problem here.
All right, then the last thing is to go ahead and put your wheel bearing seal in. Just give that a little tap with a motivator. Maybe give it a big tap with a motivator.
What we're doing is we've got this on a table that's a plastic table, so we don't have enough stopping power on the other side of the blow to make it happen, but you get the idea. You need to tap that into position, and I need to wash my hands. And one of the first things you're going to do when you're putting on the brake kit, we're finally to the point where we're actually putting the brake kit on, you're going to want to go in and mount your black bracket. Now, this kit is a front mount disc brake. Ford originally did that on these kits because this is actually what Ford used on the 65 and 6 Mustang and the 67 and the Fairlanes. When you got a disc brake kit, you got a four-piston disc brake kit for the car. And they mounted them toward the front of the car with the brakes out here. So you want to make sure you do that. Don't confuse yourself and try to mount your brakes rearward because it won't work. Now, you also have a dust shield that comes with it. So you kind of have to sandwich all this together and get that to set. I'm going to get two bolts started. Now, the rear one, you have a bolt that goes in this bottom spot here. Now, basically, this is the same setup that we had on the original brake system that held the shield in. The bottom front. And you don't want to tighten all this up until you get all the bolts started. Now, after you get everything tightened up, you want to make sure you've got good clearance between your spindle and your dust shield. Typically, that's going to be okay, but without good clearance, if this was really close, like say it got bent in shipping or something like that, you could get a little bit of a rattle between these two whenever the brakes are doing their thing. All right, now what I've done here is I've got the caliper mounted on the actual assembly. I dry mounted the caliper because in setting this up and just playing around with it, it looked like we were going to have some possible interference on the dust shield and the caliper itself. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tighten the caliper down on the back side so that I know that I've got a good solid seat on it. It's basically sitting where it needs to sit for final. Okay. Now I know my caliper's mounted where it's going to be sitting. Now you'll notice everything's still loose. What I did is I loosened everything back up so that I could actually go in and pull some space on this section right here. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put some pressure on this shield so that we can maintain the separation between the caliper and the dust shield itself. Take my 9/16 and go ahead and tighten up the bolt tightened up on this one and check my spacing. Now you may have to go in and do some mild modification to this in order to get the spacing that you want. We're really close, but we've got distance, so I feel pretty good about it. Now we just have to disassemble the caliper assembly, pull this back off, get everything molded back up. All right, at this point, I'm not real worried about getting the rotor dirty. We're going to clean it once we get it mounted on here because we've got greasy bearings and everything involved.
When you're tightening up the wheel bearing nut, I like to tighten them up really well, what I estimate about 20-25 foot-pounds, and that's just to seat the bearings. And then you got to back that off and basically do it hand tight, maybe hand tight plus just a quarter of a turn, because this rotor should spin freely. If you have too much friction in there from that nut being too tight, or if you don't grease it well, you'll build up excessive heat, which is what we think damaged the original spindle that was on this car. So we've got the rotor on and the wheel bearing nut in place. We want to make sure we add our cotter pin. That's just to keep that wheel bearing nut from turning over time. Bend that back on itself so we can get the wheel bearing cap in place. Take a hammer and a screwdriver and just slightly tap around the edge of the lip on the wheel bearing cap. Okay, so now that we have the cap sitting in there really well, we're going to give the rotor a final clean using some brake parts cleaner again and a lint-free cloth. You really want to make sure that the rotor is just free of all your fingerprints and any grease that may have gotten on there before you put the caliper and the pads on. One other word of warning, brake parts cleaner is wonderful for cleaning the rotors, but any of these little rubber pieces, you do not want to get brake parts cleaner on there. It'll dry them out and they'll just go bad. Yeah, you can kind of see just how dirty that rag got, and you don't want all of that dirt and oil and grease and stuff in between the rotor and the pads when you do final assembly. That can really have a bad effect on the performance of your brakes when you're done. And these calipers are a quick change style, so that's why we didn't have to load the pad first. Now that we've got the caliper in place, we simply slide the pads in, and we have a retainer that screws right onto the back. All right, I'm just using a 7/16 inch socket to go ahead and tighten those up. Don't go overboard on these, as they're, like I said, they're only 7/16. When you do the brake line to the caliper, make sure that little copper washer is in place. That was actually held on to the caliper by this little plug that I had to pull out. And it's just super important that you do the caliper side of that brake line first. And you should use a 5/8 inch line wrench. It'll grip onto that a lot better than just a regular open box wrench will. Okay, so now we're gonna go ahead and hook up the other side of that flexible brake hose. Now once you get the rigid line started into the flexible line, we can go ahead and put our clip back in place that holds all that together nice and snug. And once again, use line wrenches to tighten everything up. Jeff, I gotta say, the new rotor and the new caliper and everything under there, that looks really nice.
Sure does.
Kind of makes the rest of the wheel well look a little shabby though. Maybe we ought to take it all out of there and start painting and
No. That's what happened with the 67. Look how long that one's taking us. No, we said we were gonna make this car a driver. We're gonna make it a driver. What we do is we find the worst dirt road in Aiken, South Carolina, and we go up and down that dirt road until that stuff looks like the rest of the stuff in the wheel well.
And then it all matches.
And then it all matches and won't be a problem.
Well, it sounds like it'd be fun anyway.
It's a good plan.
So, oh, sounds good.
One of the other things I think we ought to do on this car is put a set of stainless lines on it from NPD and a set of braided hoses on there to kind of dress it up a little. And I think we ought to go in and paint these with some cast coat paint and a high temp paint so that these things will look nice through the wheels on your car, because the wheels you got are open face wheels. If you had a closed wheel with a wheel cover on it, I really wouldn't worry about it.
Yeah, but that's a good idea.
Because you've got an open face wheel, that's probably going to be a good thing to do.
So, what do we got going on next week?
Next week we're going to be going in and putting the dual reservoir master cylinder in there and the proportioning valve to make sure everything works really well. We're also going to show them how to go out and test that and make sure your prop valve is set up just right.
Oh, that sounds good.
So, I guess we need to tell them now, come back and watch us next week on Autorestomod!